on. I want to welcome everyone to the metro region of the Los Angeles International Church of Christ. Good to see everybody. Good to have you on here. I hope you're having a great week so far. If you're not having a great week, I hope tonight could be very encouraging. Thank you. You know, for the next 2 months, Jerry's going to be running midweeks for us. This is his first midweek he's running tonight. So thank you, Jerry. Totally appreciate that. Let me share my screen with everyone. Let's see here. Awesome. There we go. So again, great to have everybody here. Look forward to teaching tonight. You know, but for many of us, you may not know this, but Robert is kind of, he's been out in the desert right now because he is wrapping up his doctorate program. And one of the things he has to do is his dissertation. He basically has a big paper that he has to turn in by August 15th. So we as a staff wanted him to focus on it. So we're going to be, more of us are going to be teaching over the next 2 weeks for midweeks and Sundays, just so that he can, you know, get his paper done. And we're super encouraged for him. And we're grateful because of all the things that we're learning as a fellowship because of the work that he's doing in his doctorate. And his doctorate program is coming to an end after this paper. I believe the minimum he has to write is 165 pages, which is awesome. And I know he's hard at work at it right now. Michelle's with him as well, encouraging him to get all that done by August 15th. So till then, we're going to be teaching. Things are going to be still moving in the kingdom of God and in our fellowship. But I look forward to a great time of teaching tonight. But please keep Robert in your prayers as he's wrapping up his doctorate program on spiritual formation. As always, I love to begin with a question. Have you ever wondered what it means to practically love God, right? Like, what does it look like to love God practically? Is it I give financially? Yeah, that's it shows our love for God when we do that. When we have quiet times, absolutely. When we pray, absolutely. Just like even in my lesson this past Sunday about being in the room with Jesus, right? Like every time we get together as a group and we're connected with one another, Jesus is right in the midst of us. That shows our love for him. But I want to talk about some other ways in which we can practically love God, because our theme for 2023 is love God. But sometimes I think it's easy to fall into the rut of, okay, so what does that practically look like? And I want to talk about three tonight, but there's many ways to practically love God. And I hope this will encourage you in your faith. In Mark chapter 12, the greatest commandment in verse 28 to 30 from the Living Bible, it says, one of the teachers of religion who was standing there listening to the discussion realized that Jesus had answered well. So he asked, of all the commandments, which is the most important? Jesus replied, the one that says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the one and only God, and you must love him with all your heart and soul and mind and strength. The second is, you must love others as much as yourself. No other commandments are greater than these. And so tonight, I want to talk about, my lesson is entitled How Paul Loved God, because I love studying about Paul. I mean, he is such an inspirational Christian. I mean, he wrote 2/3, I believe, of the New Testament, and he's just a phenomenal, phenomenal disciple. And one of the things that I love about him is what can we learn from him? You know, what can we learn about how he loved God? And that's what I want to look at tonight. So as we begin our night, let's go to God in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Thank you. We're grateful for Jesus. We're grateful for the Apostle Paul. Help his life feed us tonight spiritually on how we can show our love for you and how we can live out the greatest commandment by loving you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And what does that look like practically for each of us? So God, bless our Bible study tonight. Encourage us, challenge us, inspire us, convict us by your Holy Spirit. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And so tonight, what did Paul's love for God practically look like? And I want to talk about three things, three ways that Paul loved God tonight. And it shows the kind of love that he has for God, for Jesus. And those three things are radical repentance, radical preaching, and radical decisions. You know, when I was doing my Bible study in this, I was thinking, wow, these things here can really revolutionize our lives and revolutionize our faith if we allow it to. And I just want to look at these three. So let's dive right into radical repentance. One of the first ways we get to see how Paul loved God was by his radical repentance. You know, I want to ask you a question. When you think of the word repentance, do you have good feelings about it or sometimes scary or negative feelings about it? Often disciples can have negative feelings about this because it implies that sin is involved in it and it is something we have to change. And yet it's our way out, basically. Repentance is our way that's always out of sin. No matter how bad things get in our life, we can always repent. Amen. You turn to the person next to you right now and go, repent, you know, because it's a great word. It's a word that gives us it's a word of second chances, basically, that if you fall short, you can always repent. And one of the ways Paul showed his love for God by the deep repentance that he had in his life with God. And because he was one, you know how like sometimes people, when they're having like losing weight commercials, there's the before and after picture. Well, repentance is like that. It's what we were like before God, what we're like after God. So let's dive right in. I want to show you what Paul was like before Christ. In Acts chapter 8, verses 1 through 3, it says, and Paul approved of their killing him. This is talking about the context of this is the first Christian martyr being stoned was Stephen. And Paul, or Saul at the time, was there approving of the killing. On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him, but Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison. BC days, right? Or before Christ days, before Christian days, Paul or Saul approved the killing of Stephen. He worked to destroy the church. He, in Acts chapter 9, verse 1, he made murderous threats. And he also went to great lengths to find disciples and put them in jail. You know, as Paul was writing a letter to people in Damascus, which is about 150 miles away from Jerusalem, he was willing to travel that far to be able to find disciples and put them in prison. I mean, think of this question. Would you hang out with Paul before he was a Christian? Would you be one of the guys or girls or women or men hanging out with Paul or Saul before he was a Christian? I mean, if you were a Christian, you would not be hanging out with him. He would want to put you in jail. He was there to destroy the church. He was a religious zealot. He was relentless. He pursued the Christians relentlessly, man, to put them in jail and prison. And he was violent of a guy. That's how the Apostle Paul, or not the Apostle Paul, that's how Saul was before he became a Christian. Think about how you were before you became a Christ, before you became a Christian. Think about how you were. I mean, I was crazy spiritually. I mean, I was violent. I was mad. I was angry. I was a woman. I mean, all these things. I was doing drugs by the time I was 21 years old, and I was a violent person. Saul was a violent guy before he became a Christian. And then a beautiful thing happens. He got converted. Jesus had to personally meet him in Acts chapter 9. And then radical change happened. And a radical change such a deep transformation took place in Paul's life of repentance that not only before this disciples didn't want to hang out with him, but even after he became a Christian, disciples did not want to hang out with him because they couldn't believe the depth of repentance that he had in his life. And I want you to be thinking about your own life, and because this is important, a way that we can show our love for God is showing how God has deeply changed us from the inside and out. You know, everyone has a private life and a public life. And me as a speaker, especially being in the ministry, everyone sees my public life because I'm always before the congregation. But only God and only the close connected few in my life get to see my private life. And Paul had such a deep repentance in his private life that outwardly it became so different as well. In Acts chapter 9 and verse 21, this is how the disciples felt about Paul after he got converted and he started preaching the message. In Acts 9, 21, it says, all those who heard him were astonished and asked, isn't he the man who raised havoc in Jerusalem among those who call on this name? And hasn't he come here to take them as prisoners to the chief priests? It goes on a little further in verse 26 to 27. When he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. I mean, rightly so, right? Like, this guy was killing Christians. You know, this guy was making murderous threats. He was on the lookout to find disciples and find Christians and throw them in jail. And he was totally okay with approving the death of a Christian. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. Before being a Christian, man, Paul was violent of a zealot trying to destroy the first century church. I mean, oftentimes we think of Paul as, wow, he's so amazing and all that. But this was what he was like prior to becoming a disciple of Jesus. And this guy was an intellectual. He was smart. He was witty, but he was also very violent. And all of the things that he was doing in the name of God. That's how blinded he actually was. But after he met Christ, you know, his life dramatically changed. And what we see, all the things that we read about in the New Testament about him, especially in all of his letters and his writings, is what he was like after he became a Christian. But even after he became a Christian, the disciples didn't really believe that he changed that much and that he really became a disciple, to the point where they were all afraid of him. And thank God that Barnabas was there to vouch for Saul or Paul. This man who's a preacher, this guy, he's known in the Christian world as kind of a hardline preacher. And this is what he said about repentance. We know that men are saved by repentance and faith, and whoever does call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But salvation is a supernatural work of God that will always produce fruit. The evidence of salvation is a changed life. Can I get an amen on that? Amen. Because the evidence of salvation in someone's life is their repentance, is how their life is radically changed. And what Paul, he was a murderer that became a martyr. I mean, that's how deep the repentance went, where he was killing Christians to the point where now he would be killed for his own faith. And so your testimony in the kingdom of God matters greatly because it shows the depth of repentance. It shows your own love for God. How much you've changed is directly proportional to how much you love God. I want you to think about that for a second. How much you've changed is directly proportional to how much you love God. And the Apostle Paul, the older he got, the more humble he got, to the point where he labeled himself as, in 1 Timothy 1, verse 12 to 15, I am the worst of all sinners. Like, he viewed himself as the worst of all sinners of every single person in the world, because he valued repentance, and his repentance showed his own love for God. And so as we think about our own spiritual lives, think about what you were like before you're a Christian and what you're like now. And also think, but it doesn't just stop there. To the day that we die, to the end of our lives, we should be in constant repentance that shows our own love for God. Amen. That's the one thing I've been trying to work on. As I grow older spiritually, I've been trying to become more spiritual and to just deal with my sin more, to be more humble in my life. I'm striving for humility. I try to pray for it every day, to learn, to always be a learner, and to figure out what can I learn from this brother or that sister or whoever talks to me or anything like that. So think about your own testimony. One way that Paul showed his love for God was through repentance. And I hope this encourages us in our faith to continually strive to want to be closer to God and get closer to him through our own repentance. Amen. That doesn't mean we walk around and just feel bad about ourselves all day long. It just means that when things pop up, we're eager to repent. You know, I love to teach my kids when they were younger, well, are you a QR? Quick repenter. You know, are you a quick repenter? Because that's really what the name of the game is. When we're Christians, it doesn't matter. Let's not get so caught up in our sin. Let's get more caught up in how much we're repenting, like Zacchaeus, where he was such a great example of what repentance looked like. That was one way Paul showed his love for God. The second way that Paul showed his love for God was radical preaching. And I want you to be thinking about this year so far. It's August already. We're in August. Think about how much you've been preaching about Jesus to others lately. Has it been good? And this isn't, I'm not saying this to make you feel guilty or anything like that. This is more just about like one way that we can show our love for God is that we preach about Jesus, that we can't stop talking about Jesus. And that's what I love about the Apostle Paul. In Acts chapter 9, verse 27 to 29, it says, but Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. This is after he became a Christian. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. He talked and debated with the Hellenistic Jews, but they tried to kill him. When the believers learned of this, now look at this. It says, when the believers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. Like Paul had a fierce love for Jesus. And that's what motivated him to flat out speak about it. You know, he was always talking about Jesus after he became a Christian. I mean, you couldn't stop this guy from talking about Jesus because he was in love with Jesus. He was in love with how much he had changed his life, and his repentance showed it not only in what he talked about before he became a Christian, but especially after. Paul wasn't afraid to die. I mean, in this instance, right, as he's speaking and he's preaching the word of God, Paul wasn't the one who wanted to escape from the religious establishment. It was the disciples who sent him away and helped him to escape. But Paul wasn't the one looking for that. He was there preaching the word of God in the midst of people wanting to kill him. Now, my question is this, why was he so fearless though? Because that's what is so amazing. That's one of the reasons why I became a Christian is I saw in our fellowship, people who were preaching about Jesus all the time. They were talking about Jesus every time we had discipling times or every time we got together, somebody shared a scripture about Jesus, somebody prayed about Jesus. We were constantly talking about Jesus. And I want to lean into our church a little bit as an evangelist of the Lord, right? This is something I'm trying to work on. I've been in a Bible study with this brother, this guy named Kevin Dillon. It's been great. He's actually been studying for a couple years, be praying for him. He's coming along great right now. But every time we open the word of God, Mark Flowers, Montel Johnson, Casey's been involved with him. Kevin Armstead has been involved with him. And as we've been looking at the Bible, the more we get into the scriptures about Jesus, the more exciting our Bible studies become because it's all about Jesus. And what we're trying to teach Kevin is follow Jesus, bro. But we gotta paint the picture of Jesus for him, though. And so think about this question. What motivated Paul to preach about Jesus to the people who wanted to kill him? I mean, like, notice the disciples took Paul away. Paul wasn't the one running away. The disciples are, let's get Paul out because we want to protect him. But Paul was fearless. And one reason I'd like you to consider the reason why he was so fearless about preaching about Jesus is because he understood who Jesus is. Paul understood so much about Jesus that he talked about it. And I want you to consider some of these scriptures when you think about Jesus, who he is to us. In Colossians 1 verse 15, it says, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. One of the great things I love about God is that we get to know what God is like by looking at Jesus. Because why? He's the image of God. That's why. So if you want to see what God is like, just do your Bible studies on Jesus. Fall in love with Jesus. Look at all the scriptures that you can about Jesus, because that'll tell you exactly who God is like. For thousands of years, people have tried to figure it out. figure out who God is. Well, we have an example. We just got to look to Jesus because he is the image of God. Another thing that we learn about Jesus, why Paul perhaps was so fearless about preaching who Jesus was, is because he's also the head of the church. And Colossians 1:18, he is the head of the body, the church. He's the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. One thing about Jesus, he's the head of the church. What I love about our church is Jesus has always been the head of our church. It's not Robert. It's not Doug. It's certainly not me. It's certainly not any prolific leader in the kingdom of God. In our church, in the International Churches of Christ, Jesus is the head of our church. In the metro region, Jesus is the head of our church. And that's, I think, when we feel this way, we can preach about Jesus. We can be proud of our church, even in the midst of our church going through hard times, you know, even in the midst of our church going through difficult times throughout the years, we can feel confident in our church and fall in love with the body of Christ, because no man and no leaders at the head of our church other than Jesus. And that's one thing, reason why I think Paul could preach so fearlessly about Christ. I want you to think about our church. Who's the leader of our church? Please don't say it's me. That is no way that could be the case. It'll never be the case. It's always Jesus who's the head of our church, and we're going to do what he wants us to do. Amen. In Hebrews chapter 12, another reason why perhaps he was so fearless in verse 1 to 2 in the New Living Translation is because Jesus is the champion of our faith. And I love this one. In the NIV, it says he's the author of our faith. It is where we get our faith from, Jesus. Therefore, since we are surrounded by a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up, and let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Jesus is the champion of our faith. He's the author of our faith. That's where we get our faith from. Amen. Not only that, he's also the source of our salvation. In John 14, verse 6 in the New Living, it says, Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Casey talked about this in a Sunday service one or two Sundays ago. And it's true. He's the source of our salvation. Perhaps this is the reason why Paul was so passionate about preaching about Jesus. He was so proud of Jesus and so in tune and aware of who Jesus is that he was able to just preach no matter if people wanted to kill him or not. But not only was he aware of who Jesus is, he was also very aware of what Jesus has done for us. I want you to think about some of these passages of what Jesus has done for us, and it's perhaps part of the reason why Paul could speak so fearlessly about Jesus to others. In Matthew 20, verse 28, you know, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. You know, he served us to save us. That's what Jesus has done for us. He's come and he's going to get, as Robert would say, in the nitty gritty, right? He would get down and dirty into our lives and serve us. Like it's not too above him, not too below him to serve us. He's there getting involved in the messiness of our lives, helped serving us so that one day we could be saved, and he would give his life away. He was not only there to serve us, he was there to, what did he also do? He willingly died for us. In John 10, 17 to 18, it says, the Father loves me because I sacrifice my love so I may take it back again. No one can take my life from me. I sacrifice it voluntarily. For I have the authority to lay it down when I want to, and also to take it up again. For this is what my Father has commanded. You know, Jesus willingly died for us. He didn't have to. He chose to. And that's what makes his death so powerful, is he didn't have to do it. He did it strictly out of love for us and love for his own Father and obeying his Father, because that was the plan of salvation for all of us. Well, what else did Jesus do for us? Well, he became poor so we could become rich. In 2 Corinthians 8, verse 9, for you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake, he became poor so that you through his poverty might become rich. Wow. Jesus became poor so we could become rich. You know, he was a king that became a servant. That's just the kind of faith he had and the love he had for us. Huge thing that he did for us, becoming poor so that we could become rich. He also became weary so that we could be rested. In Matthew 11, 28 to 29, this is one of the theme scriptures that we've been talking about in our spiritual practices about, you know, that as we get older in Christ, it's easy to get worn out and weary. But in Matthew 11, 28 to 29, it says, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." I mean, how many of you need some rest lately? "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." He became weary so that we could become rested. I appreciate that about Jesus. In Galatians 3, 26 to 27, consider this one. He was stripped so that we could become clothed. You know, one of the things about the cross is that, you know, I'm not 100% sure, but after all the Bible studies that I've done and I've looked at what different scholars have put on the table about Jesus, and I'm convinced that Jesus was nailed to the cross naked. I'm convinced of it. All the statues, everything there is all about him being a loincloth and all that. But it, from a Roman perspective, many articles have been written about, you know, disciples and especially actually not disciples, criminals being crucified naked and being shamed and humiliated, because that was the whole point of the cross, is to humiliate and shame. And so when we talk about being clothed with Christ, think about how Christ was stripped so that we could be clothed. In Galatians 3, 26 to 27, it says, "For you are sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who are baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ." I love this passage here and just thinking about, wow, we're clothed because of Jesus. He was stripped while we were clothed. In Matthew chapter 8 in verse 20, Jesus said to him, "The foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." I mean, think about that. Jesus became homeless to help us gain a home in heaven. Think about that for a second. I go, there's so many other reasons to why I think Paul had so much courage and conviction to preach about Jesus that people who were trying to kill him couldn't even stop him preaching about Jesus. It's amazing that how this man's faith and love for God really was like. And so I want to encourage us, you know, as we're getting back, you know, growing in our faith and exercising our faith to continue. If you haven't been sharing your faith, get back to sharing your faith, you know, building relationships. I'm not just saying cold contact. I'm saying building relationships with each other so that we can be in tune to what the Spirit may be doing in their life and talk about Jesus at some point in time when the opportunity presents itself. Amen. But the second way we saw how Paul loved Jesus was that his radical preaching of Jesus in the midst of persecution in his own life. Difficult times did not stop Paul from preaching about Jesus. I'm challenged by it, and I'm trying to get back to it and get it happening on a weekly and daily basis. Amen. And the last thing I want to talk about tonight before we wrap up is the third way that Paul showed his love for God. What did it look like practically is that he made radical decisions for God. You know, all of us are going to have to make decisions in our life every day, what we do and how we spend our time. And like when we are presented with a job opportunity, what kind of decision are we going to make on that? When we guide our kids in what classes to take and what's going on in school, and as they present us with different challenges in their life, how are we going to guide them? How are we going to teach them how to make decisions that are spiritual and for God and his kingdom? Well, it shows a person's love for God by the kind of decisions that they make in their own relationship with God that is played out in their daily lives. And so the third thing I want to talk about is radical decisions. How did Paul show his love for God? In the kind of radical decisions he made for God. Let me give you an example. In Acts chapter 20 in verse 22 to 24, love this passage. It says, "You know that I have not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you, but have taught you publicly and from house to house. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. And now, compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord has given me. Lord Jesus has given me the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. Man, what a passage. And what I love about this passage is it shows us Paul's priority when he has a difficult decision in front of us. And his decision was radical, is that when he was in his faith, everyone is going to have to carry their cross. And for every person, that cross is going to be different for every single person. What the cross that you have to carry is going to be different than the cross that I have to carry, or what Grace has to carry, or what Robert has to carry, or Michelle, or any one of the members of our congregation. And what I love about Paul that spoke to me is that Paul was able to make decisions that benefited God and his kingdom. In fact, he was like, look, if I go to Jerusalem, shoot, nothing but prison and hardship is coming my way. But you know what? My life, it's God's anyway. It means nothing to me without God. So I'm going anyway. And I love that about Jesus. I love that about Paul, that he's able to look at that and make kingdom decisions. That's a way we can express our own love for God. And in fact, many times when we don't make kingdom decisions, it dramatically affects our life, because it affects how we live our lives and the different outcomes that come about it, or the consequences that come about it when we don't make kingdom decisions. Well, what is a kingdom decision? Well, look at, let me contrast 21st century decision versus first century. In the first century, many of the disciples had a kingdom interest rather than self-interest. You know what I mean? It's easy to just be, what do I get out of this? When you make decisions based on only what I get out of it, it's all about self-interest rather than what does God get out of this? The decision that I'm about to make, what does God get out of this right now? How does this benefit the kingdom of God? And that's what helped me spiritually when I was growing up in the faith. Is I got to see people make some great kingdom decisions, like special contributions, one of them. I've never really struggled with special contribution, because I've always seen people who, I'm grateful for the people who gave a contribution that planted the church in Hawaii. That's how I became a Christian. How crazy would that be for me to get blessed because of others' contribution, and then I'm stingy and I'm not ready to give a contribution for the future church plantings that are going to be going out there, right? That's an example of self-interest versus kingdom interest. Think about when you're making a decision, how does this affect my life, or how does it affect kingdom life? Think about that. Running the race versus finishing the race. Anybody can run the race, but it takes a man and woman of great character of Jesus to be able to finish the race. You know, I want to be like Paul at the end of his life and said, you know, look, I've kept the faith. I have kept the faith. Now I'm ready to have a crown of righteousness bestowed upon me. And kingdom decisions is a big deal in the church. It's easy to make decisions that are only going to benefit ourselves. But when we make kingdom decisions, God gets glorified, the kingdom gets glorified, and ultimately it also affects our lives. It might be difficult in the time being, but man, it shows a person's love for God by the kind of decisions that they make that benefit God, Jesus, and the kingdom of God. Amen. And so tonight, as we're looking at some of these things, and all of us are at different places spiritually, and we just looked at three places tonight where we can look at how Paul loved God, what it looked like for him to actually love God. There are many ways to do it. I just looked at three tonight: radical repentance, radical preaching, radical decision. Think about where you might be at tonight. Some of you, you're doing awesome. Keep it up. You know, some of us have maybe fallen off a little bit. Ah, that's okay. We can always go back to point one, repent again, start preaching about Jesus, and make kingdom decisions again. That's the beauty of being a disciple of Jesus. We always get the second chance every single day. And so tonight, as you go to your discussion groups, well, what point, you know, got your attention and why? Like, what, how did this Holy Spirit touch you tonight? How did the Holy Spirit grab your attention or encourage you in your faith or shook you in your faith or made you go, man, I got to consider this, you know? No matter what it is, chat about it in your discussion groups tonight. The second question is, I always ask this, what is the Spirit telling or calling you to be or do? Tonight, let's let tonight be a reminder that we can practically love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for your attention. Good night.